Today, as you're getting seated, get your Bibles out and go with me to the wonderful text of Hebrews, the 12th chapter. We've been in Hebrews chapter 12, and today I want to talk to you about a subject called the mountain of God. Now, you'll find out what that means as we go along in the church service today. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, let me just kind of remind you of some of the things that we've talked about. We started out talking about that each and every one of us is running a race. Individually, that we are running a race of life, and that God has outlined the course for us. God is our Father. Really, if you think about him as a coach, there's going to be some course corrections along the way. That as we get off track, as we go through life and we start to develop different areas of our lives and the things of God, that there's going to be things that God needs to discipline us in. And so the encouragement comes not to get downcast or downhearted when the Lord disciplines you, but to realize that he's a loving Father that's making sure that you have the best race and that you run to win. And so we came along, and last time we were together, we talked about being bitter or blessed, that there's a choice, that we can allow that discipline, that we can allow the things of life to come against us, and we can either get bitter and turn from the ways of God, or we can be blessed and do God's will for each and every one of our lives. Now, the danger for each and every person that is a Christian is that we can get discouraged along the way. Every Christian, while running their race, when disciplined or challenged by others, and when lured to the flesh, is in danger of turning from God's ways to their own ways. And that's where we see the mountains of God. Here we are in Hebrews, the 12th chapter, verse number 18, and I'm going to start reading. I'm going to go through verse number 21 to start. Hebrews, the 12th chapter, starting out in verse number 18, says, "For you have not come to the mountain that may be touched and that burned with fire, and to blackness and darkness and tempest." Verse 19, "And the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, so that those who heard it begged that the words should not be spoken to them anymore." Verse number 20, "For they could not endure what was commanded. And if so much as a beast touches the mountain, it shall be stoned or shot with an arrow." Verse 21, "And so terrifying was the sight that Moses said, I'm exceedingly afraid and trembling." Now, all of us in our lives, we should recognize and realize that this says we have not come to that mountain. In other words, you have not come to the place that can be touched. This is not a natural, physical thing that we've come to when we've come to our life in Christ. This is not the place that is darkness and gloom. Sometimes people think that when you go to church, all you hear is doom and gloom, right? It's just that fire and brimstone, hellfire and brimstone. That's all the preachers want to talk about. It's just doom and gloom, and everything's bad, everything's wrong, everything's, the whole world is going to hell in a handbasket, and it's just like the God flushed the cosmic toilet, and we're all going down in it, and everything is just wrong. That's not the mountain that we have come to. God is saying, you have not come to a natural place in your life with Christ. This is not something that can be touched. It's not something that you can physically handle. And he says, you've not come to that darkness. See, sometimes we think of our lives and we think, well, I can't understand it. I can't know it. It's just really kind of veiled. It's not really something that I can understand. And yet, God says, you've not come to that place. Not come to the place that can't be approached. See, there was commandments that were brought under the old covenant. And really that's what it's talking about is Sinai. If you were here last week, Pastor Luke did a great job of describing the two mountains and really what they represented and what we've come to. And so we didn't come to Sinai. We are not under the old covenant or the law covenant, if you will. The Mosaic covenant, when Moses brought it to the children of Israel, they were terrified because God came down on that mountain and started burning with fire and smoke. See, we haven't come to that place where God shows up and we draw away from him out of fear. But rather, we've come to a different place in our life. See, there is a mountain. And there is a reminder that comes with these passages that we have not come to that mountain that can be touched. There is a mountain that we can feel, that we can see, that we can experience in natural ways. The mountain that it's referring to here is the pressure of trying to please God according to the flesh. See, that mountain is the weight and the pressure of our sin. And that mountain brings fear and it brings bondage. Galatians, the 4th chapter, talks about the two mountains, and it says that when you go to Mount Sinai, it brings bondage. Why? Because when you have the commandment, you would not know sin apart from the commandment. But when the commandment takes the opportunity, sin takes the opportunity of the commandment, and it brings birth to death in our lives, and therefore we died, and we were under bondage of fear all of our lives. And Jesus said he came to destroy the works of the devil and to release those who, through all their life, were subject to bondage in fear. See, when we come to that mountain, when we try and please God in the flesh, all of a sudden we're going to find ourselves drawing away from God. I can't do it, God. I can't perform enough. I can't be good enough in the natural to please God. See, it's very interesting to me when you take a look at that passage that it said that God delivered to the children of Israel through his own voice, through his own word. They heard God. The whole nation of Israel heard the Ten Commandments spoken to them. You can read about it in Exodus chapter number 19, Deuteronomy chapter 4 and 5. And the whole nation was there around the mountain. The 70 elders got to go up with Moses, and they got to have a covenant meal, and they actually saw the form of God. They saw his feet burning with stones around his feet. I mean, this is amazing things that took place. And God's intent and desire was that the whole nation would be a nation of kings and priests unto him. And yet they drew away and they said, we cannot stand hearing the voice of God and live. Therefore, Moses, you go to God and you come and you tell us what God says. And they drew back from God. See, when there are commandments, when there are laws, and when there is fear that drives us, and that bondage will take us away from God. See, the law is likened to a schoolmaster that held us captive until the time of reformation came, until Jesus came. And so it says that we have not come to this mountain. See, it's very interesting, some of the parallels when you take a look at it, that the Ten Commandments were delivered to the children of Israel, and they were written on tablets of stone. And that it was with a stone that anybody who broke the commandment should be killed by. Think about this for a second. It was a stone that they were written on, and by that stone they would die. Hello? In fact, before we had Jesus Christ in our life, our hearts were a heart of stone, the Bible says, and not a heart of flesh. See, if it's just commandments, if we try and live by those commandments, we will die by those commandments, because if you break one of them, you break them all. And by them, the justice of God will be carried out. But we have not come to that mountain. Why? Because you cannot get to heavenly places by earthly means, only by the means that God himself provides. Let me say that again. You cannot get to heavenly places by earthly means, but only by the means which God himself provides. What do I mean by that? If we are running our race and we find out that there are some corrections that need to be made, the discipline of God comes on our life. We start to notice that we are turning from God's ways, and we're starting to have bitterness towards others. There's things in our life that come against us each and every day. And the natural tendency is to try and figure out in the flesh, God, how can I change this? How can I be more pleasing to you? How can I do this? But you cannot get to heavenly places by earthly means. See, the Bible says in Hebrews the 11th chapter that if you're going to come to God, you got to come not in natural ways, but in spiritual ways. You got to come in faith, because anybody who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So you can't come to God in the natural and say, God, look how good I am. God says, that's not going to work. It's not going to make it. You have to come to me in spiritual ways. See, we have not come to the natural mountain that can be touched and yet wasn't, because of fear and the people drew back. But we've come to another place. Let's take a look at it in Hebrews the 12th chapter. Once again, verse 22 through verse number 24. Look at what it says in verse number 22. It says, but you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, to the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels. Verse 23, to the general assembly of the church of the firstborn who are registered in heaven, to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just men made perfect. Verse 24, to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling, which speaks better things than that of Abel. I mean, guys, there is so much in these verses. I thought that we might just want to start at Genesis and just keep going until we hit Revelation in the maps, and then we could say amen. So for the next 24 hours, we will be, I'm just kidding, all right? We're going to break it up. We're going to break it down. In fact, I had to pray and ask the Holy Spirit for the spiritual gift of edit. Lord, help me to reduce this down, right? Because this is so much. It's like taking a drink out of a fire hose. It just, you can't do it very well, right? But think about this for a second. Of all the things that we just read about, it's heavenly things. Angels and the New Jerusalem. And here it is. It's a spiritual place, not a natural place. It's not the natural mountain of Zion, even though there is one. Pastor Luke talked about that last week. There is a natural place that you can go touch that's called Zion here on the earth. And yet that's not what he's talking about, because it's the heavenly. It's the holy. It's the unseen. It's the spiritual. And listen to this. It's the real. Oh, come on, somebody. That's the reality. This here is what was birthed out of what is real. This is the experience that we're living in. It's physical and it's fleshy. It's the natural, but it came from the real, which is the spiritual. See, none of what we've come to can be reached in the flesh. But Jesus is the way for each and every one of us that God has provided. He is the provision. He is the ladder that we can ascend to heaven. He is the vehicle that when we get inside, takes us to the heavenly places. He is the one who bridges the gap. He is the mediator. No longer do we have a natural man, that Moses, that represents us to God, and he alone hears God's voice. Now, each and every one of us can go to God. We've been given access, and we've been given an invitation by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ to come into the very presence of God ourselves, and now we are that nation of kings and priest that can approach God. We can touch the mountain. We can experience this thing. No longer do we draw back, but we draw near. And so we need to understand what we've come to. Have you guys ever taken a trip? Maybe you took a vacation, you went to a certain place, maybe you found a beach city, and it was your first time going there, and you said, you know what, I really like this place, and I've heard about it, I heard a lot of good things, the pictures look beautiful, and so you booked a trip, right? You went down to that beach city and spent a couple days in a hotel, you and the kids, you went down to the beach and had a good time, relaxed, you know, it's just wonderful. Went to a couple of the restaurants around the area, sampled the food, and you know, just loved what you experienced. So you came back from that trip after a couple days and came home, and there you started talking to someone at work, and they said, hey, how was your weekend? Oh, we had a great time, you know, we took a couple days off, and we went down to the beach, and we had a good time. Kids played in the water and, you know, built sandcastles, all that kind of stuff. Found some really good restaurants. And your friend at work said, hey, you know what? I've been to that place. Did you go up to the cliffs and watch the sunset? And he said, no, what cliffs? And he said, well, the cliffs. I mean, everybody knows about the cliffs that lives in that area. I mean, I heard from one of the locals about it, and so I went up to the cliffs, watched the sunset. Most beautiful sunset I've ever seen in my life. And he said, no, I didn't see the cliffs. Maybe next time. Yeah, next time. When you go back there, go do the cliffs. Okay, sure. And so, you go through a period of time, then you're talking to one of your relatives, and you tell them, hey, we went down to the beach, and we had a good time, and then we went to make sandcastles, and had a good time, went to the restaurant. Someone was telling me about the cliffs. I heard about it. I'm going to do that next time, right? And then they say, oh, yeah, the cliffs, and then did you enjoy the amusement park that's there? What amusement park? Yeah, on the boardwalk. I mean, if you go down to the boardwalk, wait, boardwalk? What boardwalk? The boardwalk, just north of the beach, you just drive up a little ways of about 5 minutes, and there's a boardwalk, and they've got little rides, they've got carnival games, they got popcorn, and I mean, it's just the most fun. The kids would have loved it. Yeah, the kids would have loved that. Okay, the cliffs, the boardwalk, okay. So you ever had that experience? You're saying next time, right? Next time I go there. See, I think a lot of people, when they become a Christian, they're missing out on some things in life. See, the neat thing about Christianity is that you don't have to know everything when you get saved, right? You don't have to take a class or get your doctorate degree. You don't have to go to seminary in order to get saved. All you have to know is Jesus died for me, and therefore I'm going to give my life to him, and my sins are forgiven. That's all you got to know, right? Thank God for that, because no one would get saved if we had to know everything before we got saved. I mean, this book sometimes can be a little bit daunting, can't it? 66 books, all the different authors, all the different stuff. It's hard to understand, hard to find out. God does not have any prerequisites other than faith in the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ for your sin. Then you're saved, right? But once you get saved, it's time to find out about the lay of the land. It's time to find out about what you have come to. There are a lot of Christians who are living beat up, broke down, busted, and disgusted life. They're still walking in darkness. They still are drawing away from God. There's still that tempest surrounding. Why? Because they're still operating in the natural rather than realizing what they have come to in the spiritual. And can I tell you something? God wants you to experience the heights. God wants you to experience the thrills. God wants you to experience the blessings. God does not want you just to have life in eternity. God wants you to have life here and now. God wants you to have an amazing life. There is an adventure of faith that awaits each and every person that has come to the mountain of God. And so we got to learn about what we've come to. And so today I just wanted to pull out a couple of things, and there's so many things, like we said, that we're going to be going through, and we'll take a look at these more and more as we go throughout the weeks. But the first thing is that we got to realize we've come to a heavenly place. We've come to a heavenly place. This is not a natural place. It's not a physical place. We've come to a heavenly place. Think about it. You've come to Mount Zion, to the holy city, to the New Jerusalem, to the heavenly, right? In the book of Revelation, we get a picture of this. Turn with me to Revelation chapter 21, and we'll see the New Jerusalem. Apostle John is getting caught up, and it's not into a natural place. He's getting caught up into a spiritual place. We'll see this as we read Revelation chapter number 21, last book of the Bible. If you hit the maps, turn around, come back. Revelation chapter 21, we're going to read verse number 10. And then we'll read verse number 23. Revelation chapter 21, verse number 10, take a look at it with me. It says, and he carried me away. He's talking about an angel. Carried him away, look at this, in the spirit. This is not a natural thing. This is a spiritual thing. He carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain. Remember, we're talking about the mountain of God. Talking about the holy place that we've come to. So here John gets a picture of it in the spirit. He carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain. And he showed me the great city, the holy Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God. Notice that it is not going from the earth up to God. This is descending out of heaven from God to the earth. This is not a natural place. This is a heavenly place that we have come to. Drop down to verse number 23. The city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. See, we don't understand that in the natural, right? We understand when I woke up this morning and I looked outside, the sun was shining. And I could see everything around me. But here, the New Jerusalem has no need of natural means of illumination. The New Jerusalem only has need of the glory of the Lord for illumination. Now look at the last sentence. It says, the Lamb is its light. This is not a natural thing. This is a spiritual thing. And you cannot get to heavenly places by natural means. In other words, if the city doesn't need the illumination of the sun, but it rather needs the glory of the Lord, how do we see that? We see that in Jesus is the revelation that brings the illumination to our lives. In other words, when you look at life, oh, this is so good for all of us. When you look at life, if you look at life through natural eyes, you're going to get natural results. You're going to see things in the natural. You're going to get discouraged. There's going to be that fear, that darkness. I don't understand, God. What are you doing? What's happening here? Why is this got to take place? You know, I've been working and it's not working. I've been striving and it just seems like I'm hitting a wall. God, I don't understand what's going on. The attacks of the devil are going to come against you and you're going to think that it's just happenstance. God must be angry at me. And you're going to draw away from God because you're looking in natural eyes. But when you start to look at life in the light of the Lamb, when you start to take a look around and you see Jesus in everything, all of a sudden it illuminates the place that you live in because you are not in a natural place. You have not come to that mountain. You have come to the mountain of God. You have come to the place where the Lamb is your light. You have come to the place that has no need of natural means of illumination. You came to the revelation of Jesus Christ, and now your life makes sense. God, I see what you're doing over there. God, I may not know now, but God, I know that you're up to something good behind the scenes. God, I know I'm hitting a wall, but God, I know you're developing some character. And see, when you start to look at life through the light, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path, because Jesus is the word. C.S. Lewis made a brilliant statement. He said, I believe in the sun as it's risen, not only because I can see it, but because by it, I can see everything else. See, we need to see life. We need to look around, not with natural eyes, but with the eyes of the Spirit. Let the illumination of Jesus Christ come into every area of our lives. What have we come to? We've come to a heavenly place. Not only that, we've come to the company we belong to. Think about it for a second. The language of Hebrews chapter 12 is almost overwhelming when you start to get a picture of it. Go there with me in your imagination for a moment. Here is the heavenly Jerusalem. Massive, all right? Just massive, massive square, massive place. It's beautiful. It's decked out. The streets are made of gold, so transparent you could look through it like glass. You ever seen gold like that here on the earth? I mean, that's just an amazing thought. It's illuminated by the Lamb, but then all of a sudden it says, to an innumerable company of angels. You ever been overwhelmed when you looked at the forest and you started to try and count the number of trees and all of a sudden you just gave up? You ever taken a walk in the middle of the night? Maybe you drove out to Joshua Tree National Park about an hour and a half away and you looked up into the sky at night and you went, wow, look at all the stars. And all of a sudden you started seeing beyond the bright stars and then you started to see into the Milky Way and you started to see into the galaxy. And all of a sudden God just opened up your eyes and you just went, whoa, there's so much out there, right? You ever had those experiences? Maybe you started going to the ocean. Maybe you remember as a child or as an adult for some of you guys, going to the ocean for the first time and looking across the vast expanse of the ocean and you got overwhelmed. Think about those experiences for a moment. Now picture going to heaven and there you are in the New Jerusalem, and even though it's massive and even though it's grand, then you started to look around and you notice there's so many angels around me right now, and he makes his angels a flame of fire. They are ministering spirits sent before on your behalf, and all of a sudden you just started to realize, whoa, there's a lot of these guys around me. But not only that, there's the church. Oh, come on. There's Abraham, there's Isaac, there's Jacob, there's Rahab, there's Ruth, there's Esther, there's David. There's all the great and mighty men and women of God that you read about in the Bible. And you start to look around and you start to notice, man, I don't know all these people. I don't know everybody here, but it's the General Assembly. It's the Church of the Firstborn. These are the ones whose names are registered in heaven. And all of a sudden you realize, I'm overwhelmed. There's so many. But not only that, you're a part of that company. Wow. You have a place in the family. There's a seat at the table with your name on it. God has invited you to the marriage supper of the Lamb, and he welcomes you in and says, my son, my daughter, this is your place. You can sit right here. See, it changes life when you realize that there's more for you than are against you. There's more for you than are against you. 2 Kings chapter 6. Some of you guys felt lonely coming into this place today. Some of you guys looking forward to this week and saying, you know what? Tuesday's going to be a lonely day. I'm all by myself. Start bellyaching. Start feeling sorry for yourself. 2 Kings chapter 6. I'm all alone and nobody knows the trouble I see. You want me to finish it, don't you? Nobody knows but Jesus. Listen, you and Jesus is still a majority every time. Every time. Every time. Every time. You're never alone because you got Jesus. But not only that, there are a new... See, look around. Do you see some empty seats in the place? There's some empty seats in the place. Those seats are not empty. If you could see by the Spirit right now, there are ministering flames of fire. The Spirit of God. There are the angels. And there's a great cloud of witnesses all around us. See, you just need to have spiritual eyes to know that there are more for you than are against you. And you belong to that company. 2 Kings chapter number 6, Elisha, his servant... They're there in their house. And Elijah gets a word from God that the king of Samaria, he's going out. I'm sorry, Syria. Syrian army's moving. And so here Elijah sends word to the king of Israel, and he says, hey, don't go over here. Syrian army's going to be over there. If you go over there, you're going to be hurting for certain. And so he says, okay, well, I won't go over there. Now the Syrian king comes along, and he says, hey, what's going on? There must be a mole, because they've been avoiding us. And so he brings his guys... up in front of him, he says, who's the rat, right? I'm paraphrasing now, all right? Who's the rat, okay? One of you guys is giving our information, our military secrets away to the enemy. And they say, no, my lord, no one's giving away any secrets. There's no rat here, but there's a prophet in Israel. And what you whisper in your bedroom, he proclaims to everybody. And so he says, well, if I'm going to get military victory, I got to take out the prophet. So what do? They go down and they surround his house. Now the servant of Elisha, one morning, he's going out, he's got his cup of coffee, and he's going out to get the newspaper, right? And so he's still rubbing his eyes and getting the sleep out of his eyes, that sort of thing. He bends down, he gets the newspaper, and he looks up, and there's the army all around them. He drops his cup of coffee, he throws the newspaper, and he goes back inside. He's freaking out, and he says, Master, the Syrian army's all around us, chariots, horses, men. Weapons. What are we going to do? 2 Kings chapter number 6. Take a look at it. 2 Kings chapter number 6. Verse number 16. Elijah answers his servant. He says, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. See, in the natural, when you look around, you might say that the earth is getting darker. Oh, yeah, it is. But those who are with us are more than those who are with them. Some of you guys like Elijah, Elisha's predecessor. You may have gone up to the Mount of Horeb, right? And there at Mount Horeb, you might have gone to God and said, God, I'm the last one. God, I'm the only one. God, no, nobody serves the Lord. And the Lord kind of slapped you around and said, hey, what are you doing? What are you talking about? You're not the only one. Quit bawling. Quit squalling. Stand up. Stand up like a man. Stand up like a woman. I have reserved for myself thousands who have not bowed their knee. You're not the only one. There are more that are for you. There are more that are with you than are against you. Now look at the next verse. Look at what it says in verse 17. Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Now that young man had already seen something in the natural, right? We are not talking about physical eyes opening. He says, open his spiritual eye, open his eyes so that he may see. Not the natural, but that he may see the reality of what's going on in the spirit. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man and he saw. And behold, look at what it says, the mountain. Oh, come on, somebody. You haven't come to the mountain that can be touched. You have not come to that mountain which pushes you away from God. He saw. And look at, behold, and the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elijah. See, there are more that are for you. There are more that are with you than are against you. And that ought to make somebody happy in this place today. Wow. We're better because of who we're with. The Bible says a companion of fools will come to ruin, but he who walks with the wise will be wise himself. See, some of you guys need to stop hanging out with the old crew because they're dragging you down. Some of you guys got to stop accepting invitations to the bars, to the clubs, to the scene. Some of you guys are just wanting to get the approval and the acceptance of man. And so, you know, they're all going down to the sports bar. They're all going to go down and hang out at the racetrack. They're all going to go down and they're going to be gambling at the casinos and it's dragging you down. See, you need to get a hold of the company because you are better because of who you are with when you are with the company of God. You need to get faith-filled people surrounding your life. You need to be in a place like this where there's people going to lift you up and encourage you and say, you can do it. Come on. You go, boy. You go, girl. This is, you got this. Come on, there's more that are with you than are against you. We're better because of who we're with. Thomas Wheeler, who is the CEO of the Massachusetts Mutual Life Insurance Company, tells a story about him and his wife. They were taking a trip, and here they were driving through a small town. It happened to be the town of Thomas Wheeler's wife. And so there they stopped at a gas station, and it was a full-service gas station. So he got out of the car, and he told the attendant, why don't you go ahead and fill up with gas, check the oil, check the tire pressure. I'm going to stretch my legs and walk around the building and come back. So he walks around the building. As he comes around the building, he notices the attendant and his wife are having a conversation. And they're talking, they're laughing, smiling, leaning in. So he's like, what is this all about, right? So he walks up to the car and she says, oh, here's my husband. And looks like it's time to go. It was really good seeing you again. I'm so happy for your life. And maybe we'll see you again sometime soon. And so Thomas nods to the man and gets in the car and starts the car and they start to drive off. And he says, what was that all about? Did you know him? And she says, remember, this is where I grew up. I went to high school with that guy. In fact, we dated in high school. Now, Thomas, he gets a little smile on his face and straightens up in his seat and he says, well, aren't you glad you married me, the CEO, and not him, the gas station attendant? And she smiles and she says, honey, if I would have married him, he would be the CEO and you would be the gas station attendant. See, we are better because who we are with. Every married man in the place better be saying amen right now. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. What have we come to? What have we come to in this church service? We're laughing. What have we come to? We have come to God, the judge of all. Last thing for today is this. We've come to God, the judge of all. Now, again, that title judge can be scary, right? Everybody in America right now, don't judge me. Don't judge me. No judgment. No judgment. I would encourage you, if you haven't heard it yet, Pastor Deborah preached 2 messages on judgment. It will blow your mind, okay? But we've come to God who is the judge of all. Now, yes, we understand that when God wraps everything up, that there's going to be a judgment seat of Christ, that there's going to be the sheep and the goats, one's on his right, one's on his left. But if you are a Christian, realize that you have not come to commandments that condemn any longer. For those who are in Christ Jesus, there is now no condemnation. Why is that? Because your sin was judged at the cross. And the punishment, the righteous punishment, the just punishment for your sin was poured out on Jesus on the cross. Therefore, if you are in Christ now, you died with Christ and the punishment was carried out in you already. So as a Christian, you do not have to fear judgment of sin because your judgment for sin is in Christ. Okay, now I know this is new to some of you guys. Remember, we're talking about the cliffs. We're talking about the amusement parks. We're talking about all this stuff that maybe when you came to this mountain, you did not realize you had. Some of you guys are so afraid to go to God. Listen, your sin has already been taken care of. All you got to do is take it to God and say, God, I messed up. I put this under the blood in the name of Jesus. Please forgive me and please cleanse me according to your word in 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9. And therefore, God is faithful and he's just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then don't do it anymore. Hello? Repent. Repent is me turning from your way, changing your mind, changing your heart, and going towards God. You change when you repent. You don't keep going back to it saying, it's okay, God will just forgive me again. No, 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 no. But your sin has been judged at the cross. So then what is the believer's judgment when we go before the Lord? See, the world will be judged. And we understand that the wrath of God against those who do evil is being stored up. And either that wrath was poured out on Jesus and I'm already in Christ, therefore it will pass over me because Jesus is my Passover lamb, or it's resting on me if I'm not in Christ. So therefore, the judgment for Christians is different than the judgment for those in the world. When we go before the Lord, the Bible says that our works will be brought before him and that our works will be judged and the fire of God will hit our works when we go before God. And that our works are made of one of three different things. Some good, some bad. It's either wood, hay, and stubble, which we know that when fire hits wood, hay, and stubble, it's what? It's burned up. It's consumed, right? Or it's made of gold, silver, and precious stones. When fire hits gold, silver, and precious stones, what happens? It's refined, if anything, right? It comes out clearer. It comes out without any impurities in it. And so we understand that if our works are going before the Lord to be judged, to be burned, therefore, we better watch what we do while we are here in the body. Not to get saved, but so that when we go into eternity, those things which remain, we will receive a reward from, right? Or we will suffer loss and we will come out smelling like smoke. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't like to smell smoke. I want to have a reward. I want to have something that endures. When God starts to lift up his presence and when the angels bow down and they praise and the pillars shake and when all the elders fall down before him, when people start casting crowns at his feet, I want to have something to cast at his feet. Yeah, right. So how do we know what's good and how do we know what's evil? Well, I told you we should have started in Genesis, right? Let's go back to Genesis for a second. Here's Adam and Eve in the garden. Adam and Eve, you don't have to turn there. Adam and Eve, right? Here they are in the garden. Everything that they do in life, they're doing because God delivered to them his will and his way of doing it. Adam, tend the garden. Adam, I want you to name the animals. Adam, take to you your wife. Adam and Eve, I want you guys, you can tend the garden and you can eat of any tree of the garden except one. The tree of the knowledge of good and of evil. Now, up until this point, Adam and Eve had never made a decision for themselves on what was good and on what was evil. They just believed the word of the Lord and carried out his will and his way in their life through obedience. Eve was deceived as the serpent came, right? Here, Eve sees that in the natural. She sees that in the natural. She sees that the tree of the knowledge of good and of evil has fruit that is good for food, that is good in the natural for food and for making one wise to determine what is good and what is evil. To be like God in that sense, right? But to be like God apart from God, you cannot get to heavenly places with natural means. So she's deceived, she eats, and she hands to her husband. Her husband was not deceived. The Bible never says Adam was deceived. Adam rebelled willingly and made a choice for himself to enter into sin, and he ate. Their eyes were open. Their natural eyes were open. But before that, all they had was the spirit. Now their natural eyes are open, and on that day that they ate of it, just like God said, they surely died spiritually, they died. See, up until that point, Adam and Eve had never made a choice, never made a decision based on their own opinion. Now, we think in the natural, right, maturity is being able to make decisions for yourself. And we would understand that. We would say to our children, you need to make some of these decisions for yourself. You need to understand how to conduct yourself. You need to make healthy choices for your life, right? But maturity in Christianity is different than making choices for yourself. Maturity in Christianity for believers is making decisions based on God's judgment about those decisions. Are you listening today? It's going back to the garden state. It's going back to that, not New Jersey, it's going back to that place where God is the one who determines for your life what is good and what is evil. That means that we do not make decisions based on our education. We do not make decisions based on social structures. We do not make decisions based on our family upbringing. You're going to have to break from all those things in the natural. Listen, you guys, you cannot make decisions to get to heavenly places based on natural means. Therefore, you have to get spiritual. You have to realize the place you've come to. You've got to go to the mountain. You've got to go to the judge of all and say, God, what do you think about this? And therefore, I'm going to release my judgment of what is good and of evil, and I'm going to allow you to be the judge of my life. Everybody's tracking? Clear as mud? All right, praise the Lord. When you operate according to the will and the way of the Lord, and when you do what is good in God's eyes according to God's judgment, when the fire of God comes down and hits your works, you don't have to fear loss. Why? Because you didn't do it your way, wood, hay, and stubble. You did it God's way, gold, silver, and precious stones. Is anybody listening today? You don't have to fear judgment. You don't have to fear judgment of sin, and if you operate according to God's ways, you won't have to fear judgment of your works. Jesus is our example. John chapter 5. Turn there with me. John chapter 5. We've got to run. John chapter number 5. Jesus shows us this. Now, you would think Jesus could make a decision for himself, right? This is God in the flesh. Shouldn't Jesus be able to say what's good and what's evil? Shouldn't Jesus, God in the flesh, come and say, I got all this. I got this down. Listen, because I said we got to run doesn't mean everybody run out of the room, okay? Stay put. Remember, stay till the end of the church service. We already laid this down. Stay seated, okay, because you're going to miss out. Here's Jesus giving us the perfect example of what life should look like. John chapter 5, verse number 30. Look at what Jesus says. Jesus says, I can do of myself, I can do nothing. I can of myself do nothing. Wait a second. Jesus. You're Jesus. You're God in the flesh. You should be able to do something by yourself. But Jesus says, I can't do it. I can of myself do nothing. As I hear, I judge. And my judgment is righteous. Why is that? Because I do not seek my own will, but the will of the Father who sent me. We see this all throughout the life of Jesus. Before Jesus makes any major decision, before he chose the disciples, before he goes and does great mighty works, what does he do? He goes off on his own and he prays. And he seeks the will of the Father. Jesus knew the word of the Lord so that he could do the will of the Lord. Jesus, before he goes to the cross, here he is praying, here he is crying out. He was all God, but he was also all man. And there was an anguish, there was a pain. There was a just gut-wrenching pain that was on his life. It was anguish to the point of blood drops sweating out of his body. And he says, Lord, if there be any other way, then God will take it. But not my will, but yours be done. What did he do? He submitted himself to the will of the Father. Even though in my own judgment, God, I don't want to go to the cross. God, I don't want separation from you. I don't want to carry the weight of the sin of the entire world, past, present, and future. I don't want to experience that. That's why Jesus on the cross cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why? Because he was experiencing that crushing. He was experiencing the grapes of wrath. He was drinking the cup of God's wrath down to its dregs. And yet Jesus laid down his judgment of, this is not good and I don't want to do it, to God, not my will, but yours be done. See, when you lay down your judgment and you don't make decisions for yourself, but you make decisions based on what God already has laid out for your life, you don't have to fear the judgment. Jesus was given the highest place. In each and every one of our lives, as we release judgment to God now, we will not fear judgment for our deeds later because we know that they are right in God's eyes. Galatians chapter 2, verse number 20. The apostle writes and he says, I have been crucified with Christ. Guys, I'm dead. He says, it's no longer I that live, but it's Christ who lives within me. And the life I live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and who gave himself for me. See, we don't walk by sight. We walk by faith in the Son of God who loved us and who gave him for us. Why? Because he is the light that illuminates our life. He is the one that we've come to. He's the heavenly place that we've come to. It's the company that we've come to. And it's the God who is the just judge of our lives that we have come to. There's more to come in this series. Come on, everybody, let's pray. Let's pray. Take a moment, just close your eyes. What's God speaking to you today? What has God spoken to you already? If you haven't taken a moment to write that down yet, just take a moment, write down what you believe God is speaking to your heart. What is it that God's ministered to you? Maybe God has ministered to you about operating in the natural more than in the spirit. Maybe God's encouraged you today and that you're a part of the company. You have a part and you have a place. Maybe today God is speaking to you and he's saying, you need to release your judgment of things and you need to take my judgment. Let me make those decisions for you. Release control. Let go. Whatever it is, just write it down right now. Just write it down. Take a moment, jot a note down on your phone or on your tablet. Write it down the leaf of your Bible. If you're here with your husband or your wife, would you just take a moment and whisper that in their ear, whatever God spoke to you, maybe show them what you wrote down. Maybe you're here with a friend and you'd like some accountability to what God spoke to you. Maybe you want to share that with a friend right now. Father, we just love you today, Lord. We receive your word with meekness. God, we will readily submit ourselves to what it is that you've spoken to us today. God, we thank you for the word of the Lord. God, we thank you for where we've come to. We haven't come to a natural place that can be touched. We've come to the heavenly place. Lord, may we live our lives. May we experience all that you have for us. God, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor. In Jesus' name, everybody in agreement said, amen. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hallelujah. But ask everybody, just take a moment in this place. And would you just do something for me? Just get a private moment with God. Would you bow your heads and would you close your eyes? Just don't let anything distract you right now. Bow your heads and close your eyes. And I want you to think about your life. What if today was your last day on the earth? What if you died and you went before God, the judge of all? Where would your life end up? Would his judgment be that you go to hell? Or would it be that you go to heaven? Sometimes people think, well, I don't believe in hell, but it's a very real place. God doesn't want you to go there. Jesus spoke of it, and you can't avoid it by denying its existence. God doesn't want you there. He's not mean-spirited. It's not the will of God. It's not the plan of God. And yet God loves you so much, he gives you free will choice where you end up. Sometimes people think, well, all roads lead to heaven. No, they don't. You can't get to heavenly places by natural means. Not all roads lead to heaven. That's like me saying all roads lead to the moon. You can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you will never make it. Sometimes people think, well, I've been good enough that God will let me into heaven. Listen, this is not about your good works. You can't do enough good deeds to get you into heaven. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Can't be good enough to get you in the same way you can't be bad enough to keep you out. God loves you and he wants you to come to him just as you are. Sometimes people think, well, I was raised in church and my parents told me we were Christians. I was baptized a Christian as a child, went to religious classes, wore religious jewelry or a t-shirt that said Jesus. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. In church today, I mean, I showed up today, that should count for something. I consider myself to be a Christian, you know. Got involved in my last church, sang in the choir, helped out, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions. People thought of me as a leader. Even got a membership card to that church, taught in the Bible class. I think that I've had enough church that God will let me into heaven. But you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say attend enough church, volunteer enough, be baptized a Christian as a child, be born in America, that you get to go to heaven. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that your church involvement will get you in. You can sit in church as long as you want. It will not make you a Christian. That's like me saying, I want to be a car. And so I go to my garage and I call myself a car and think that that's going to make me a car. It doesn't work like that. Same way you can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. Maybe you're sitting there thinking, well, I think I know enough about God. I know God. I mean, I celebrate Easter and the resurrection every year, sing the songs at Christmas. Could quote scriptures to you, Pastor. Doesn't that mean I'm a Christian? Well, no, it doesn't. How do I know that? Because the devil believes that Jesus Christ is Son of God. He can quote scriptures and that doesn't qualify him for heaven. Demons believe that Jesus Christ is Son of God and they shudder when they think about it, because of a fearful expectation of judgment. Today, let's not play around. Let's not mess around with God. Let's not play games. It's God's heaven. We got to get there God's way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. You got to get there God's way, and God's way is through Jesus Christ, his Son. It's not just enough to know about him, because everybody knows about Jesus in America.
Not just enough to attend a church or be good. It has to be something that takes place in your life. Jesus gives us the way. He says, you must be born again. Now, I know society's made a mockery out of that term. Hollywood's raked it through the coals. But let's not let them define for us what being born again is. Let's let the Bible do that for us. From the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant that you've given God all of your heart and that you've given God all of your life. It's just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you in the last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to a church, just like he's speaking to every single one of you here in this church today. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. That's graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what is he saying? He's saying lukewarm Christianity is not real Christianity at all. What is lukewarm then? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. Occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. And today, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. But today, let me not just leave you there. Let me give you an opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to lead those of you who need to do this in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart, to be born again, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. And all you got to do to be included in that prayer, in a moment, I'm going to count to three. One, two, three, just like this. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together, just like that. Bang. All you got to do to be included in that prayer is simply raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You can put it right back down. So if that's you in this place and you know you need to make a change, you know that you're headed for hell. Maybe you don't know if you're headed for heaven, but you want to make sure today. Today, make sure. Come on. Or maybe you're lukewarm and you've just been playing games. Listen, stop messing with God. Stop playing games in this place. It's time to get right with God. To give him all of your heart and all of your life. Who should raise their hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure? Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this before, never said yes to Jesus, given him all of your heart and all of your life? I'm speaking to you. Finally, if you look warm in this place, you know that you're lukewarm when I described it. Get ready to get your hands up. I'm going to count to three and pop my hands together. You want to be included in this prayer in a moment. Get ready to get your hands up. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high right now if that's you. Thank you. There's one. There's two. God bless you. There's three. Thank you. Four. Got you over here. Five. Got you over there. Thank you. Five, six over here. Got you. Got you right there. Thank you. God bless you. Six, seven up here. Okay. Got you up there. Thank you. Thank you. Who else today? Anybody else? You want to be included in that prayer? Don't miss this opportunity. God's speaking to your heart right now. I got you up on top. Thank you. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? Anybody else? Just want to take a moment. About six or seven wise people. You want to be included in this prayer in a moment. Get ready to get your hands up. If you're listening in the foyer, if you're down at the Love Rock Cafe, if you're online, hey, you can raise your hand right where you're at too. God sees and God's watching. Then you can join in this prayer with us. Anybody else? We're going to pray. Get your hands up right now. If that's you, don't wait another moment. Your heart's beating out of your chest. God's speaking to you. Come on, let's go for God today. Anybody else? Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about six or seven wise people. Hallelujah. All of you who raised your hand, or if you should have raised your hand, but you didn't, I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. We're going to pray together, okay? So I want to get you down here so we can pray and we can change destinies, all right? So let's all stand and welcome them. You raised your hand, you should have raised your hand. If your children raised their hand, ask them, did you raise your hand? If they say yes, bring them right now. We want to pray with them. Come on down. Let's welcome them. Let's give them a hand from the foyer. If you need to come in right now. Come on. Let's pray together.
To worship you, I live to worship you.
They're coming. Come on, you can come too. This is your time. This is your moment.
To worship you, I live. To worship you, I live to worship you.
All the way on top. Come on, if you raise your hand. If you raise your hand in the family rooms, come on in. Come on in during this time. This is your time. This is your moment.
To worship you,
let's go for God today.
To worship,
they're still coming.
I live.
They're still coming. Come on, you can come too. There's room here at the altar for you.
To worship you, I live. To worship you, I live.
All right. Are you guys coming? Come on. Come on. Anybody else if you need to come? This is your time. This is your time.
To worship you, I live.
Hey, everybody up front. You came to give God all your heart, came to give God all of your life. This is the best decision of your life right now. I'm going to lead you in that prayer that we talked about. Remember, this is a spiritual thing. It's not a natural thing. So I want you to put your hearts on the Lord. Okay, and as they're still coming, that's okay, they can come. I want you to put your hearts on the Lord. And I'm going to lead you in a prayer, simple phrases to invite Jesus into your life. Now, if you mess up on a couple of words, that's okay. Okay, this is about your heart right now. So let's all put our hearts in the Lord. Everybody's going to join in together. I want you to bow your heads and close your eyes. Put your hearts on the Lord and say, Father God, I come to you now in Jesus' name. I give you all of my heart and all my life. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he came, that he died, and he's raised again to life just for me. Come into my heart. Be my Lord. My Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Wash me with your blood. Cleanse me of my past. And fill me with your Holy Spirit. Let it be known that from this day on, I am a Christian. I'm headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Well, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hey, you guys. I want you guys to look right over here to my right, your left. This is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really good guy. He wants to give you some free stuff, free information, help you find out what to do next in your walk with God. Okay, so don't go back to your seat. If you follow Pastor Joel right this way, he'll let you come right back out in a couple moments. Your friends and family will wait for you, okay? Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise today. Hallelujah.